to follow this final part of chapter 4. And also the USB key is circulating, and I suggest you copy all the 4 files because they are the final version of the chapters 3, 4 parts of the 5 and chapter 10. Then you can just copy the 4 PPT that are in some place between you. Then all these 5 are the final versions. Better to keep this version. The topic I want to start here is the topic related to optical distribution frames. And the detailed information about this subject, it's on L50. And this is also called optical termination frame. It's a optical passive node that which resides in the central off environment, and this offers a way to organize fibers and also a good way to store the pigtails and guide the cable inside that frame. When we use the term ODF, it doesn't include the means of routing cables and pigtails outside the frame. That's known as pigtail ducts or raceway system. The term frame refers to a mechanical structure, and the cables are attached in that structures, and this frame also holds other elements. Could be a rack or a shelf time structure, and it's a passive node, as the other information we already deals in 3.1 are applicable. It's a general view of one possibility. And the ODF provide the general functions of test access and organizing the cable fiber, the connectors, the jumpers, and termination nodes and distribution nodes in the fiber network. The functionality and the flexibility at the fiber distribution unit is especially important when the fibers in the network are brought into service over a period of time, and with different types of service, geographic distribution of service, and connector type and activation procedures may change, and the ODF could help all these activities putting the activity in a more organized way. And there are 2 main configurations. The first one, the connectors can be installed on the cable and then connected to the bulkhead connector on the ODF. The other configuration is to use connectorized pigtails that are spliced in the cable, and the pigtail is then connected to the bulkhead connector. And jumpers then can connect the distribution frame to the transmission equipment. And depends on the situation, the jumpers can have long distance, long length, because of the long distance expected in some case. There are some cases where you not to expect rearrangements. In this case, the cable and also the fibers can be taken directly to the equipment frames and connected directly to the transmission equipment, eliminating the distribution frame or patch panel. It's important to consider that sometimes it's necessary to provide a replacement of the connectors, the pigtails, and the fiber splice due to some errors or rearrangements. In this case, excess fiber is stored in a fiber organizer near the fiber splice. And then it's an example. It's giving figure 4.8, when we can see all the frame, the cable, and the fiber organizer, termination point. Then this structure is here to organize all this transition, all the transition between the cable and the transmission equipment. There are a lot of applications that are mentioned in the recommendation. And the first one is the fiber termination at transmission equipment. Then, as shown before, the ODF means a safe and ambient to do this transition in a good manner. And the other application is related to fiber rearrangement at network nodes. There is a lot of possibilities of rearrangement that are shown here, and the ODF must contain the structure to organize and to give the right path to the fibers. In this case, to make easy that rearrangement. Also, it's important to consider the application of the ODF related to testing. In this way, the connectors in the fiber distribution unit permit attachment of test equipment such as power meter, optical fiber domain reflectometer to locate break and to measure loss. It's an easier way just to go to the ODF, disconnect the fiber, do the test, and put the fiber in place again. It's an easy way to do the testing. And finally, one application that's shown in the recommendation and also in the handbooks is signal modification. The connectors at the ODF are also convenient locations to attach passive signal modification devices, such as attenuators. Sometimes copper and wavelength division multiplexers may also be attached. In other times, it's more common to have them in a separate device. There are some aspects related to the cable fiber and jumper management that's necessary to consider. The first one refers to the bending radius, and it's necessary to use bending radius not smaller than 30 millimeters to ensure the residual strain of the fiber will not exceed 0.2%. However, more and more now fiber designs could use bend radius under this, and it's necessary to consider what kind of fiber you have in each situation. The cable fiber and jumper management must consider that a splice of fiber in service should not disrupt by installation of the new fibers or maintenance of installed fiber. Then it's important to consider that the fiber distribution unit should be chosen to accommodate all the types of splices that we are anticipated to be used and to adapt easily the new ones without changing the situation of the fibers that are in service. Another important point is that it's necessary to have a suitable slack so the cable fiber stored in a fiber organizer should not experience bends below this value, 30 millimeters. In fibers in service should not experience such a bend. There are also considerations to be done related to the attenuation, and some new kind of fiber could help this being less sensitive to bending radius, but also there is some consideration about mechanical effect, affecting mechanical properties of the fibers. And the design of the OT device need to consider this point. Also, there is a necessity of considering some points related to connector management. There is a large range of in the number of connections in the fiber distribution unit. And sometimes in the central offices and network nodes, there may be up to 500 or more connections. In the customer's premise, there may be only one or few connections. And furthermore, more fiber are usually installed than are needed. Some are connected to once at once, with the remainder being brought into servo as demand increase. Then it's necessary that the design and the dimensions of the ODF are done, are projected, are installed, considering these factors. Especially that the number of connectors usually increase with time. When we discuss connector, we use that factor that relates the connector with the capacity to put a larger number of connectors in the same space. Here is one of the application of that consideration. Another point is there is also a large range in available space at the network node and termination. It's necessary to have this in mind. And usually, the space originally planned for fiber termination unit becomes too small as unexpected demand and growth occurs. And the fiber distribution unit should provide for a high density of connectors while maintaining easy access and allowing effective management. We always need to think that this kind of connection of fiber is more and more used, and the number of connectors we will have in the future could be higher than we are planning. Another point important to consider in the ODF is that there is a fast technological evolution, and it could result in a shorter life for a bulkhead connector than the fiber network. This way, the fiber distribution unit should provide for easy replacement of a bulkhead connector without affecting the fiber in service. There are some climatic considerations also that are being done in this part of the text, and as mentioned sometimes before, it's a wide range of climatic factors for fiber distribution unit. May are installed inside a human occupied space or have temperature and humidity variations. In some way, being installed in the outside plant and need to endure broad temperature and humidity variation, because the fiber distribution unit installed in open and exposed to the sun's radiation typically receive more thermal stress than those installed in the five central offices near transmission equipment. Then it's necessary to consider the, since the beginning and what kind of ambient. Remember that big table with several, with five different ambient conditions. It's necessary to plan the ODF considering one of these conditions. Regarding to mechanical consideration, fiber distribution units are installed in a wide variety of situations, including rack, cabinets, and wall mounting. And the fiber is often added to an existing network, and in this case, small size is important. Then we need to put more fibers in the same structure, and considering what kind of installation facility we have in each situation. Another point is that the fiber distribution units installed in the open and in manholes will receive more mechanical stress than those installed in central office in other building near transmission equipment. Experience indicates that more fiber optic cable will be added to the network over time. Fiber distribution units that can grow in incremental additions will gracefully accommodate the fiber. It's always necessary to consider a position to have more fiber distribution units in the available ODF. Any question, any comments about the this consideration regarding to ODF? It's important to remember that this kind of guidance affects a lot the products that are put in the market, and it's very important to have in mind this consideration to project and after to install good structures, well controlled in terms of mechanical characteristics, in terms of protection to the fiber, and also in terms of facility of expansion. That these are the main goals of the this recommendation, and it helped a lot to have more adequate ODF in the field. If there is no question, we can move to the next topic, that's fiber closers and fiber organizers. Again, the L13 has some detailed information about this topic. It could be considered as a reference document to more detailed view of the fiber closer and fiber organizer. The main point addressed, the first point addressed at the recommendation is that when an optical node resides in an outdoor environment, that's generally contained in a sealed enclosure. And this is commonly also referred to an optical closure, optical cable joint, or optical sheet joint. Then when we use optical closure here, we are referred of all these elements, and the name established at the recommendation is optical closure, but it means also optical cable joint, optical sheet joint. The optical closures comprise a mechanical structure, generally named closure housing, and that is attached to the ends of the sheet joining, and a means, an organizer for containing and protecting the fiber and passive optical device. Then both together, the closer housing and the organizer help to put the fiber in a safe situation. There is some functions the opto closure need to give to the network. The first one is to sealing to the cables, and also the mechanical attached to the cable and protection of the contents of the cable. This way, the optical closure will restore the integrity of the sheet, including mechanical continuity of strength member when required. Also, will protect the fibers, fiber joint, and optical device from the environment in all types of outdoor plant, aerial, direct bird, in ducts, and underwater. And also will provide for the organization of the fiber joints, passive device, and storage of fiber overlay. And finally, we'll provide electrical bonding and grounding of the metal parts of the sheet and strength member when required. Then, within having this in mind, we can look to the recommendation regarding to design characteristics of optical closure. The first one is that the closure housing design employs either cold or hot system, and it depends on the sealing method used. There are a lot of material or forms to use, mastic, tapes, grommets, O-ring, cured rubber shapes, paste, potting compounds, rubber gels, and adhesives in cold or cold process. And all of these are what we call cold process because it doesn't involve the heating. And there are all set of other solutions that use heat, like thermal shrinkable materials, hot melts, polyethylene injection, welding. And in this case, the heat source could be an electrical resistance heating, could be infrared heating, could be hot air, or could be also a gas flame. Regarding of kind of closing process used to seal, the materials used for making the cable joint should be compatible. The design may allow joining two or more cables, and the cable could be different size or types. The design should allow the joining together of at least one pair, and sometimes without cutting all the fibers. And this is also known as external load, mid-span closure, or balloon splice. And it's desirable also that the closure can be reopened when it's necessary, without interrupting the working circuits. It's also recommendable that the closure has a single design, which may be used for all the applications and also in outdoor environments. Another consideration is that if the joint sealing encapsulant is used, information is required for adjustment in certain time due to variation of the ambient temperature and humidity. These conditions, the ambient temperature and humidity, generally affect the behavior of the material. It's important to have in mind the information about this to reach the better final state of the material put in the closure. If we intend to use reopening to use reentrable close, is not recommendable the use of encapsulant. And instead of encapsulant, it's better to use a solution like O-ring or something like that. Then we can easily reopen the closure housing without affecting his functionality. And if a heat source is required to seal the closure, and our closure to cheat, it's necessary to have a suitable heat source, gas flame or electrical power, and ready to be available at the joining point. It's important also to have people trained to well control this heat source without doing any permanent damage or to the personal or to the materials used in the closure or in the cable. And finally, all materials that are exposed to environment must be sufficiently resistant to fungi, and the materials exposed to solar radiation must be UV resistant. Regarding to fiber organizer, and specifically regarding to the design of the organizer system, this organizer must be considered as an integral part of the optical closure. They are comprised of one or more sheets or trays that have the means for routing and holding fiber joints and fiber overlaying. And it's necessary to plan to design the organizer to do this in orderly manner and do it in a way to minimize the fiber strain. Some important characteristics of this fiber organizer are that they need to provide means for routing, storing, and protecting optical fiber and other passive devices in a predetermined order from one cable sheet end to another, all the way between the both cables. It's important to separate the optical circuit in one of the separation level, as defined in the recommendation L51. The number of fiber joints in one organizer may vary according to the size and the shape of the fiber joint and according to the number of fiber in a cable subunit. It's necessary to ensure that the fiber bend radius should not be less than 30 millimeters in case of general application. Some special application using especially fiber G657 could be a lower curvature radii. But in order to maintain the mechanical reliability and maximize the loss in the network, the cumulative length of fiber exposed to this smaller band radius should be limited. The idea is to use the less as possible. Another important point is to provide easy identification and access to any of the stored fiber joint, especially for rejoining. And also is important to separate optical circuits up to the appropriate separation level, as indicated in L51. And the reason for this is to limit the risk of interruption of the traffic to those fiber that belongs to the same group of circuits. And it's a way to help the people that need to do some future work in the same closure. Finally, it's important to remember that to provide this function, one of the functions of the fiber organizer is to provide a mean for storing the fiber overlaying required for joining and for possible rejoining in the future. Have in mind that suggestion, that recommendation of considering the length necessary for three re-splice. In terms of configuration of the optical fiber organizer, the trays or sheets of an organizer may be configured in one of the following ways. First is lateral sliding from the frame, so like to remove a book from a shelf. The second one is rotation over a hinge. It's what is shown in the figure 410. It's like doing this movement, okay? Similar to turning page of a book, we access the other trays or sheet just moving this way. The other possibility is lifting from a slack. It's similar to lifting a book from a slack. And unrolling, similar to locating a page on a roll. There are four possibilities, and the idea is that all the movements of the organizer part should proceed in one of these predetermined ways in order to eliminate optical losses or interruption of traffic due to organizer modification. Then, as we have cable reaching that part of the with a lot of ways and splices. And so when someone needs to reach one of these, it's important to have all the conditions to move the other parts without changing the situation and just access and change the situation, the fiber we are interested in do this. Any question, any comment about? Yes, sir.
Thank you. If you can elaborate on the cumulative length of fiber, which you said should be limited in terms of radius. I mean, which has been exposed to this small radius, you said should be limited. If you can elaborate on how this cumulative length is, and if you know the number, I mean, if it can be quantified. Yes, elaboration on what actually is cumulative length of fiber. It is here. Because it said it should be limited. I thought if we have, you have the value.
I got your point. And the point refers to the, here we have all condition. Let's start from the beginning. The first important point at the fiber bending radius shall not be less than 30 millimeters. Then a good fiber organizer will consider this in the project, and the operator will just put in the right path, and everything will be okay. That's the idea. The second point is that there are some applications involving fiber with different sensitivity to the bending radius, that this kind of fiber will not be so affected in terms of attenuation as the conventional fiber. Then in this case, could have we can have an ambient with bend use rate lesser than 30 millimeters. In any case, the mechanical properties will be affected in both situations the same time, because when we change the bending sensibility, we change the fiber to with more sensibility to the curvature, we reduce the effect of the bending in attenuation, but we still have to consider the effect on mechanical properties. Then it's important to have some fiber overlaying to reassess. It's important to have excess of fiber to do the future operation. But the recommendation is don't let more than you need. Because the more fiber you have in that point with a smaller bending radius, the more will be the probability of have some mechanical degradation. then keep the amount you need to work well in the future, it's important, but keep the less length possible, the less possible to do the re-slices and so. That's the main point of this recommendation. Is that more clear now? Okay, thank you. Any other question? Yes, sir. First one? This one. The picture. Okay. This is what you are showing here is a cable coming with some tubes with fiber inside. Okay. In some place here, the tube is cutted. Then we have just fiber. Each fiber has some space to have extra length, and each fiber goes to some position of splice here. Then it's possible to enter in this closure with the tube. The sheet is well connected here, then the mechanical continuation is guaranteed. Each tube is put in some position and tight, maintained in the position. And the fiber are, that's mean of organizer, and the fiber are organizer in the way we have extra length for each fiber. And one specific fiber can go to the position of the splice that could be done here. Then you have the splice and the fiber goes. And in the other way, you have the same fiber going into the tube of the other cable and continuing. That's the idea. And one of the main points is that if you sometimes you have not all the fibers spliced, you just splice the fiber you need. That's the idea. Then the fibers that are not spliced, they are here and fixed in a point. If someone needs to splice more fiber, he just open the case and identify the fiber because there is a logic in the put in the fiber, then just look into the position and the document. It's easy to know where is the fiber we need to splice. Remove the fiber not splicing, realize the splice, put the splice in the right position, and it's done. That's the main idea of all these topics, because it's not so easy to get a cable of sometimes almost 100 fibers to find some small number, 5, 6 fiber, to do just the splice of this fiber. And in the same way, a lot of other fibers are in service. Then we need to do this splice. We need to put the new fiber in service or change for rearrange the fibers without affecting the service of the other tens or more people that are receiving service. That's the main reason of this relatively complex structure, and that's why it could be so useful to have this in some part of the network. If you are doing this in a station, central office, there are other solutions. If you are in field trying to establish a new way to some customers or some using some fiber installed, that's one of the best way to do. And of course, this option here. Then you can move one of these because sometimes you need to reach a fiber in the third tray. Then you just move one, move the second, move the first, the second, work in the third, put in the right position, close. It's fine. That's the idea of all these recommendations. It's important to the people to use well, to know how to use well, but it's important also the people who design this kind of structure to know and to build a good solution and make easier the life of the people that need to to do some work in the job in the future. That's the idea. And also, the first application of this kind of recommendation is considering the necessity of the people that work with the fiber, allowed that the people in charge of project design device like that use good practice following all these recommendations. That's the main idea. Any other question? Just a comment. Sometimes before, most of you are trying to get more and more information. The recommendations are just an important source, and sometimes the manufacturer trying to give a lot of information in specific handbooks related to the products and so. And they trying to put in more technical words how to do this operation in an or another specific device. It's a very important source. They are wonderful material, well prepared and clear, and more people are using some video, sometimes in YouTube, showing the people doing this work. It's nowadays it's a very important source of knowledge. Just know, like in this case, to find the one of the suppliers of this kind of equipment and to know how they give information to the people that need to be trained. In the past, training could be just done in some place. Now it's every moment people can access and see more in details. And one of the goals of one activity like this, I was talking to Gerard, is just to give to everyone the let me say in easy words, a taste of what we are thinking. Then the people that has the taste of what the way the things are is starting to looking for more food of knowledge. That's the idea. Thank you. The last point of this chapter, the last clause deals with passive node elements for marine and submarine cables. Of course, this system has some specific characteristics, and some general are the characteristics that already appears before, and some are added now just to characterize this more drastic situation that is have to install cable in application like that. The first block of information refers to the marinized cable. That's every time we have 6.1, we are using one of these devices to marinize cable. And after that, we have the 6.2 that are related to submarine cables. Now, regarding the fiber supplies in marinized cable, these components, in many aspects, are the same that use it in the terrestrial cable system. However, there are some specific requirements. The first is that the more common used supplies in marinized cable, due to the small size, low loss, and low reflection characteristics of the supplies, as well the reliability, it's necessary to use fusion, not mechanical. The way they apply the electric arc fusion supplies are often reinforced by heat shrinker sleeve in order to protect the supplies from stress. And the electrical arc fusion supplies are essentially the same than in terrestrial cables. Then we use fusion, not mechanical, and try to protect a little more than we, these supplies are normally protected. And most of the time, the spliced area of the fiber, that is that area that was removed all the coatings and accesses the bare fiber. In marinized cable is usually to apply a new coat, to recoat at the same size of the virgin fiber, using the same or similar materials used to original coat the fiber. And this means this provides a very small sizing, and sometimes it's virtually indistinguishable of the spliced size. Then it's one of the difference when you usually do splice in that box like we shown before. It's easy to find the place the splice because it's a protection. The fiber comes and becomes a larger structure. For submarine cable, people develop protection that put the coating almost the same that we have the coating in other parts of the fiber. Then after splice, we just look some portion of the fiber that has the splice. It's impossible to find where the splice is. That's one way to they choose to have as a situation as near as the fiber we have in another part of the cable. And for terrestrial marinized cable, there are two main objectives to the fiber splice. Then the first one, minimize the splice loss. And second one is to ensure a strength reliability suitable for the long-term true proof test. Then the conditions of the proof test realized after the splice in fiber using in marinized cable, it's has a high level of protection than in fiber normally used in outside plants. The second set of recommendations refers to the fiber organizer. The organizer accommodates the spliced optical fibers in their splice, and it's necessary always to have slack fiber to that's required on optical fiber, and it's necessary that the slack being accommodated that a bending radius is greater than a minimum allowed fiber bending radius, typically more than 30 millimeters. The same situation we have in other kind of cable. There are some considerations that we need to do concerning fiber organizer. The first one is bending radius. The second one is the accommodation of the slack. And the third one is the heat resistance, because sometimes there are heating process like molding of polyethylene, heating shrinkable sleeves. When you use this process during the assembly of a splice closure, was the organizers that we are doing with organizers, they should have suitable heat resistance characteristics in order to withstand the temperature involved. It's necessary to compatibilize both characteristics. The other factors are related to vibration resistance characteristics. And the splice organizer should accommodate the splices such that the vibration during installation and service that could be very different in application like that than in an application as we discussed in the chapter, in other points of chapter 3. And this is necessary that the fiber organizer consider this kind of vibration during installation and service in the way that the splice not cause movement in the splice within the organizer, and also in a way not to allow the violate of the minimum bending ready requirement. It's especially important to ensure that any splice reinforcement point, since these are comparatively harder and heavier than the fiber, then it's important that this reinforcement, they still in the position and not be a source, could not be a source of stress in the fiber. They are there to protect. It's necessary to be at the position to not affect the fiber. And the design of this organizer should be chosen to be suitable for cable design, size, and number of fiber. Then should be designed considering specifically the cables and condition used in this marinized terrestrial cable. Regarding to closures, the splice closure for terrestrial marinized cable is designed to restore the integrity of the sheet, including mechanical continuity for strength member of the terrestrial marinized cable that are quite different from the other cables, and to protect the cables, the fibers, fiber splice and optical device from external environment, water, and unwanted handling. Again, in the design of this must consider all the special conditions this cable will be, and to provide also proper storage of fiber splice device, passive device, if any, and excess of fiber, to resist corrosion, to prevent hydrogen effect. It's a very important point because in marinized and submarine cable, we have some closed ambience. And even in other kinds of closed ambience, we normally open the closure to do some action, and there are some new air, new ambient inside the closure. In case of submarine, it's still closed for a long time, and some materials could generate hydrogen, that this hydrogen could penetrate the fiber and reach the core and increase the attenuation. Then there are a lot of ways to prevent this hydrogen effect. Someone affects the kind of fiber, other affects the kind of material that are used in this application. I mean, material that has lower hydrogen being generated. And it's necessary to consider this, especially in closures. Another considerations to allow re-intervention on cables and splice to provide for electrical continuity if required. Sorry, that's all the points. There are some physical and structural factors also. First one is size, second one is weight, bending force, strength members, mechanical strength, and corrosion resistance characteristics. It's important to have all of this in mind, considering this cable will be in the water, could be in lakes, could be in rivers, could be also in ocean. It's necessary to consider all these points, considering the final application. And finally, in a molding process, if used during splice operation, the closure design should limit to a temperature as not to damage the fiber coat or the fiber splice. The main components of this system are the cable entering section, the pressure resistant chambers. There are some tiles and there are some bolts that are protection used to smooth the closure cable transition in the passage to the cable transporter and over the sheet in relation where such equipment is used. There's, in this case, it's better to have a transition in the dimensions regarding to the closure and the cable. Then it's not as sharp as we can see in outside plan. They, instead of having just a cable go inside the closure, they put some protection just to give you a smooth transition, okay? It's easier to use this kind of surface. There are some considerations related to beach closure, and that the marinizers normally joined to the terrestrial cable in a manhole near the landing point. It, that's called beach closure. It's used to make this connection. This may be a specially designed closure and may be a terrestrial splice closure with auxiliary components for anchoring the marinizing terrestrial cable. The idea is that the first closure that we have when reach land, it's necessary to be special to consider the design of the cable only terrestrial, for terrestrial use, but only the cable that's only designed for marinized use. Then it's necessary to compatibilize these two cables in the disclosure. Another recommendations are done for the submarine cable, and there is complementary information in G977. And everything it was said in the 6.1 about fiber splice, fiber organizer closure, and beach closures of marinized cables apply also to submarine cable, taking account the different depth of layer of the cable. Could be up to 7,500 meters and instead of the 300 meters. Then the protection of the cable, some elements, the aspects related to the electrical power, and need to take the same characteristics, but also to consider that important difference. Moreover, there are two passive nodes that are specified in submarine cable. The submarine repeater housing and the branch unit. The submarine repeater housing, it's housing just to keep the repeater, and a branching unit is a specific closure. It's a specific closure when we want to get another cable together, branching unit, because in the first case we have one cable going to another section of the same cable, and the branching unit we have one cable goes to in two different ways. The submarine repeater housing is mechanical piece part of the repeater. The submarine repeater is the equipment that essentially includes one or more repeaters or amplifiers and associated device. And the submarine repeater housing must be designed to allow operation, laying, recovery, and relaying in large depth without no degradation in mechanical, electrical, and optical performance. Then, even though in the deepest situation, the design of submarine repeater housing would be must be done in a way to allow that the cable is put in the bad ocean, sometimes could be removed to some repair and so, and put again. Then we need to operate, lay, recover, and relay in a large depth. There are a few technical requirements for submarine repeater housing. Some refers to the internal unit, that we have more than one kind of active element, most of the time for redundancy. The second one refers to corrosion protection, and this housing should be designed to not suffer from corrosion to the sea water. Another refers to water pressure resistance, because it's necessary to support the larger pressure strain in deep sea water. There are requirements regarding to high voltage insulation, because we use high voltage insulation to feed electrically all the equipment all the way off the cable. And there are also It's also necessary a thermal management because the heat generated by the electronic component inside this closure, they may be dissipated sufficiently via thermal conduction, and it's necessary to do this inside that hose. It's important also to consider the conditions to sealing, and the repeater must be provided with a protection against water and gas ingress, both directly from the surrounding sea and from the actual cable leakage resulting. Because if there is some leak in the cable, this unity generally are very expensive, could reach $1 million. And if there is some breakage in the leakage in the cable, it's needed to protect that water doesn't come inside this unity just by the section that was cutted off the cable. And it's important also to consider ambient atmosphere control, and the reliability and proper operation of the components may require a controlled internal atmosphere regarding to relative humidity and expected gas that may be generated inside the repeater. The last unit we have is the branching unit. It's generally called also the BU. That's an optical node in which it's possible to interconnect three cables and not only two as in terrestrial closure, then allowing a complete connection among the cable. Then this picture gave us opportunity to see several things. First one, that's the size of this BU is roughly the same size of a hose that have amplifiers inside. Then the dimensions are around 50 to 70 centimeters in diameter and around 2.5 meters long.